In 1994, Rwanda was devastated. Over 200,000 people were killed, slaughtered in a genocide. Over 500,000 women, it's estimated, were raped, women and young girls. It destroyed the country. They were on the verge of collapse. International organizations began to invest in Rwanda, but they invested in a very special way. They invested in women. They started a lot of small micro-enterprise businesses. They found out what the women were good at, the skills they had, and they invested in them. And for the first time in those women's lives, they had a place at the table. They had a financial stake in their community. It was an amazing transformation. And for that country, it began a way back. Today, in 2017, Rwanda, despite being still poor, is one of the fastest growing economies in all of Africa. The women didn't just stop with the micro businesses. Once they got the sense of control over their own lives, they began to step into new arenas. And what you see is that today in Rwanda, a very large percent, 64% of the parliament in Rwanda is made up of women. Compare that to our country, where 19% of women are represented in Congress. It's a really tough thing to think about the fact that women have such little power. When we look at what's happened to women across our country, we think about the fact that women behind bars today in our country, that 60% of them, 60% of them have women at home under the age of 18. We also think about the fact that in the last few years, since 1980, our country has increased the number of people who are incarcerated, women incarcerated, by over 700%. So in 1980, we had a little over 26,000 women incarcerated in the United States. But today, we have over 215,000 women behind bars. In some ways, when I think about Rwanda and I think about the incarceration of women and men in our country, because I didn't even add into that the equation of all of the men that we incarcerate, we are the largest incarcerator of people on the face of the earth. So when you think about Rwanda and the devastation that happened there to their people, I can flip that around and think about the prison industry and what that's doing in our country to many of our communities, to our people of color, to the poor. Because when we incarcerate them, we set them up for another failure. Within 3 years of release from prison in our country, over 50% are back in the criminal justice system in one way or the other. And people begin to no longer believe in themselves. Their community no longer believes in them. It creates that whole idea of a self-fulfilling prophecy. When I don't feel good about myself, I do things that I shouldn't do. Research tells us that for us to believe in ourselves and to do good things in life, we have to hear good messages. We have to have people tell us that we're worthwhile, that we're important, that we're valued, that we're special. And unless we hear those messages, it's really, really hard for us to change our lives. We all know how difficult change is. In 2012, a group of us got together and we created a program that we called Labyrinth. We called it that because we saw Labyrinth as a journey to begin to heal for the women in our community who we began to listen to, our most vulnerable, our least employable women. So we started Labyrinth. Labyrinth does a lot of, we have a lot of tools that we use at Labyrinth. It's a very small program that started out with a half-time social worker and no other staff. But we began a journey to try to find a way to help these women heal. So what we did was we reached out to two organizations around the country who have been working with the same population, one in Denver and one in Nashville, Tennessee, and they've mentored us this entire journey. They taught us what tools we needed to use in order to reach the women, in order to connect with their spirit, in order to plant the seeds for growth to occur. One of the things that we do is we have a lot of art experiences. We have so many artists in our community who willingly give of their time, and they come in and they meet with the women and they teach them new art experiences. And art isn't just for art's sake. Art is a way to connect with who we are at our core. It's an opportunity for us to feel good about what we've accomplished. And this particular quilt was done by a group of women around our table at Labyrinth. And each of the women were encouraged to take a piece of fabric, cut it all up, and create a block. And that block is what you see. It represents about 10 women up there. But in the process of creating that block, they were asked to tell their story. They were asked to use colors and shapes and designs and words if they wanted to tell the story of their hope, their loss, their love, their dreams. And as they did that, they began to share with all the other women in the room. And they began to share the pain that they had been through. They talked about their incarceration. And what they found was that for the first time, maybe for some of them, that other people listened and cared. And then when this quilt was finished, they were so proud. They were so excited about what they had accomplished. And everyone told them what beauty they had created. And for them, they could see that they had some beauty inside themselves as well. This house that you see was one of two properties that we were helped to buy in this community, and we were helped to create. These were distressed properties. These were condemned. These were a mess. And over time, volunteers came from all walks of life, church groups, youth groups, students, many, many students, the building trades, all the laborers. They all came and they all helped us gut these buildings and rebuild, which is sort of the motto for what we're trying to do with the women. Take away the pain and help them to rebuild. A cute side story on that is, as we would work on the houses, the weather was often really nice, we'd be outside. People would come by and give us a thumbs up on the color or thumbs down on something we had done. One woman I will never, ever forget walked by one day and she said, "I used to be ashamed to tell people I lived on this side of town. But seeing what you all are doing here for these women, I'm proud." So our journey of changing these two properties also helped to begin to reinvigorate that neighborhood. The women had an opportunity, something that many of us probably have never done, they certainly never had, was to walk in the Labor Day parade carrying this enormous banner for all to see, because they wanted the opportunity to tell everyone thanks. They wanted to say to the building trades, "Thank you so much for helping us." They wanted to say to the students, to the church groups, to all the volunteers who came, "Thank you for making this a possibility for us, a place where we can go to heal, a place where we can go to study, to talk, and gain support, and also a place where many of us can live." We had one story that I wanted to share in particular. Our women tend to not have very good educations oftentimes, and then they come out from prison and there's very little that they can do, because women's jobs are often in the fields that sometimes their felony makes them impossible to be employed in. So we have a class where we run a 12-week class and expose them to the building trades. Because the building trades, they don't really care if you have a felony. As long as you're there and work and put in your time and are responsible, they will hire you. So we expose them to the women electricians, women plumbers, women sheet metal workers. So at the end of that 12 weeks, we thought it was really important to have a party, a celebration, a graduation, we called it. And at that graduation, we had the women invite their friends and their family members, "Come in for this party, we are going to celebrate." We asked each woman to put on a cap and gown, and we took their picture. And to the woman, we heard the story, "I've never graduated from anything in my life, I've never even maybe completed anything. I did this. This little framed photo of them in a cap and gown is sitting on their dresser, I'm sure, at home. And it's a constant, a daily reminder that they can complete something, that they can be successful. So when I talked about the quilt earlier, I talked about the women's story. What I want to tell you now about this quilt is that it's almost done for Labyrinth. We've been guided by these two wonderful programs, and we have one more piece of this quilt we need to put together that I'll talk about. But if you think of this quilt and each of the blocks, think about it as each piece that we've added over the last few years to reach out to these women. We have a lot of art experiences, photography, journaling, crafts, certainly quilt making. We also have a job coach now. That's one of the blocks of this quilt. A job coach who works with the women, who works with not just the women, but the employers, and tries to help set up a stage where these women can be successful. Because many of our women have not had good success in their jobs, we need to have a transition into the work world for them. So the job coach does that. She meets with the employer, she meets with the women. Let me tell you a story of a woman I'm going to call Sarah. And Sarah was one of the women that had worked with our job coach. She'd had a good job before she went to prison. She got into trouble with drugs and alcohol. She went off to prison. And she came back, and the job coach was trying to help her find another good job. But success was not to be hers. She got rejection. She got that word no over and over and over again. And the job coach was beginning to worry, because all of us know that when we hear that word over and over again, we begin to slip ourselves. We begin to start not believing in ourselves any longer. But Sarah decided that when she went out for the next job interview, she was going to take control of her life. She went out, she met with the employer, and she said to that employer, "This is my story. This was my incarceration. This is my addiction. But this is my recovery. And I promise you that if you will hire me, I will be the most motivated, dedicated, genuine employee you've ever had." It worked. And that employer hired her, and she is a very successful employee to this day. So we have all these programs. We have a mentorship program where each woman, over time, our goal is for each woman to have her own mentor, kind of like a big sister, kind of like a best friend, somebody that they can meet with and talk with and share their stories with. But there's one piece of the puzzle that's still missing, one piece of the quilt. And that quilt will be complete when we launch our next piece. That next piece is our own micro business. Much like the women of Rwanda, we need this opportunity. We need to have a way to employ our least employable women, our most vulnerable women, until they're ready to move out into the community. We're calling it, with the help of a graduate student, because they are wonderful, they came up with the name, why don't you just call it the Clean Slate Project? So the Clean Slate Project is getting close to launching, and it will employ those women who, for a time, need to be in a sheltered environment while they're still getting counseling, while they're still meeting with their probation officer, while they're still having to go and do urine drops. They will have a place where they can come back every day and work. And that project will complete the entire quilt. We plan to follow in the steps of these two other programs. Instead of having a recidivism rate of 50% of our women returning to the court systems within 3 years, we're going to be like our role models. We're going to have that down under 10%. That's our goal. And this last piece will help us get there. We, being a lot of volunteers, decided that it's really not a good thing to have a full-time agency with all this going on, run by a bunch of volunteers. So our program merged last July with the YWCA because it has the same mission to empower women. It has the same mission for social justice. And so now our program is a part of their program, and it's overseen, and it's in a very safe and wonderful place. Our volunteers planted the seed in the ground, and now this program is growing it. So I think to wrap it up here, think about national devastation in Rwanda and what that does to a country, to a people, to a culture. Think about what the personal devastation happens to an individual who's been raped, assaulted, abused. That's the story of most of our women. We need to find a way to reach into their spirit. We need to find a way to nourish that seed. And that's what Labyrinth is all about. And the quote that's there at the bottom is the one that we sort of feel is part of who we are. We believe the women, when they come to us, have forgotten who they are. But we believe that they have come to us so that we can help them remember and heal. Thank you very much.